Hello to every Skivers here, and welcome to the Skyrim Whisper. I hope you're all doing well, and that you're ready to put your mind into the depth of Skyrim's lore. Today, we are going to talk about the goddess of beauty, love and art, Dibella, and her unexpected connection with the Moth. Well, the goddess mentioned in Skyrim, whose temple can be found in Markarth, is the one from the Imperial Pantheon, the cult of the 8 or 9 divines, depending on which political color you choose to wear. She is described as a popular god of the 9 divines. In Cyrodiil, she has nearly a dozen different cults, some devoted to women, some to artists and aesthetics, and others to erotic instruction. A quote from the Varieties of Faith in the Empire book. It's not a surprise to see her Cyrodiilian version in Skyrim's modern belief system, since the province was integrated in the Empire by Tibir Septim during the late Second Era. The modern Dibella has little to no known connection with the Moth, but rather is symbolized by the lily, a common flower associated with beauty, purity and charm, as its delicate appearance and mesmerizing smell indicates. It is this very flower that can be seen at the top of Dibella's statues. However, it's not the case in ancient Atmoran Pantheon, which were the ancestors of Nords during the Merethic era. The Etadas were represented as animals back then, and Dibella was no exception. While there were more conventional animals associated with gods, such as Tsun the bear, or Yunyol, believed to be the Atmoran version of Yulianos, as the wise owl, more surprising connections were made with some of them. Shtun, brother of Tsun, was a whale, or there were the boar as the god of craft. Dibella, as you're probably guessing, was the moth. Now, when we think about moths, we think about the ancestor moths. They are present in the Dungal DLC, which are required to read or comprehend the Elder Scrolls we found. This is where we learned that the Ancestor Moth Cult is an ancient group of Cyrodiilian monks focused on gathering, protecting, and reading the scrolls. Monks are trained all their lives to read and understand the Elder Scrolls by following both meditation and rituals that involve moths. The Ancestor Moths are believed to be linked with the Ancestor's Wisdom, whose voice or will are sung by the moths, directly or through their silk. Silk used to weave magical tunics and robes. The monks take care of many moths, kinda raising them, breeding them and feeding them, collecting the silk to embroider clothes with genealogic patterns. These moths are therefore a strong symbol in the Elder Scrolls universe of ancestors, wisdom, comprehension, prophecies, time, and the Elder Scrolls themselves. But what is the connection with Dibella? Why is Dibella shown as a moth? Out of all the Etadas, it would be more fitting for Yunyal or Akatosh Sphere, as Yunyal is the god of knowledge, which is exactly what we want from an Elder Scroll, or Akatosh with his relation to time. Furthermore, the first cult of the Ancestor's Moth was originally under Yunyal's influence, as many of the monks worshipped him. The main role of the Ancestors can even be related to Orkay, the snake god of mortality and life circle, and it's not absurd to think about the Deofull, which means demon in Atmoran, woodland man Hermamora, whose sphere govern dark and secret knowledge. However, the animals and representation don't have anything in common with the moth, and therefore ancestors' moths. For Akatosh is a dragon, Yunyal an owl, Orkay a snake, and Hermamora an hermit or a crab. Dibella, out of all the divines, heritated all these Elder Scroll, knowledge, time-related things that the moths is. But maybe we are going to the wrong direction. After all, the moth is indeed related to the Elder Scrolls, but we shall not forget that it's only one species, the Ancestor Moth. Not all the moths are Ancestor Moths, and from what we know, both in the Dawnguard DLC and the lore, only Ancestor Moths can help to read an Elder Scroll. Maybe Dibella the Moth is not to be confused with an Ancestor Moth, but just regular ones, implying that her symbolism is detached from the Elder Scrolls or from knowledge. But considering this possibility doesn't cast away all the problems, on the contrary, it can add some. A moth is a weird animal to embody beauty, art or sexuality. It is mostly a nocturnal bug, commonly associated with darkness, secrets and death. Even in our world, moths are linked with death because of the pattern that some of them have on the thorax, which resemble a human skull. Another negative trait is that they are considered pests in many countries due to the caterpillar of some species that eats both clothes and food storage. Why didn't the Admiral use the diurnal counterpart of the moth, showing Dibella as a butterfly or even a dragonfly? It still embodies the transformative meaning of the bug that turns a kinda ugly being, the caterpillar, into a gracious, delicate and flying one, a common parallel with the artistic discipline that turns common things into work of art. A butterfly or a dragonfly is a solar symbol, and light in its attractive effect is a fitting trait for a goddess such as Dibella. Beauty, sensuality and art are closer to warmness, brightness, than to the night and the cold that it implies. After all, fertility is associated with the sun, as life can grow thanks to its rays, and love or sexuality warm the heart and the body. Even artistic passion can be described as a fervor and utter enthusiasm. In addition, diurnal bugs are much, much more colorful than their nocturnal counterpart. Dibella, represented as a dull nocturnal bug, seems really weird. However, one kind of moth will be maybe fitting. It's the only moth species that we can find in the Skyrim's game that is not an ancestor moth. I'm obviously speaking about Luna moths. Luna moths are really, really common in Skyrim's lands. They can be found at night, spawning between 8 and 11 pm. The interesting thing about them are both their appearance and their alchemical effects. Your eyes will catch them fairly easily, for they are kinda luminescent, and they really are mesmerizing thanks to their ethereal features. They are indeed thin, delicate, and somewhat translucent, giving them an almost ghostly and magical vibe, physical traits that hint their own alchemical effects. For Luna Moth wings, effects are invisibility, regenerate health, fortify light armor and damage magicka. Maybe it's these very ethereal and delicate traits that wanted to be shown through Dibella. Moreover, nocturnal bugs are attracted by light, much more than their day counterpart. For lighting a torch in plain light is pointless. Maybe choosing an animal that knows the value of light is relevant here. After all, Dibella embodies the value of art, beauty and sexuality, but the valor of something is much more precious when it's rare. We languish for all of these when we are in the middle of despair, troubles, sickness and boredom. Dibella doesn't teach beauty itself, but the act of glamorizing, improving, embellishing our vision of the world, find the beauty in the ugliness, find the light in the night, and cherish it firmly, for it's a scarce and ephemeral thing. A butterfly in plain daylight is pointless for Dibella, and doesn't show the process that she cherishes. Yet, there is a problem. If you ever looked at Dibella engravings in ancient Nordic dungeons, you can see that she has her animal form above her. However, the shape of this moth and the ones that surrounds her is ambiguous. In one way, they resemble Luna moth for these wings forming a tail behind them. However, the big one at the top of the engravings has no tail whatsoever. You can imagine that it's due to the lack of space. But I think Bethesda concept artists would have found a way to put it anyway. But in the other side, it doesn't look like an ancestor moth either. nor spring light or dusk light moth. The one thing that is closer to a lunar moth is the eye pattern, for only this species has it in the game. Yet, drawings are not necessarily identical to what they represent, especially with such theological meanings. We can imagine that the bug shape is not relevant here, and that the eyes are not here to mimic a true pattern, but works as a symbol. Eyes symbolize comprehension, vision of what is hidden or forbidden, prophecies and divination. The central moth has three eyes, one in the middle, a huge wink to the third eye mystical powers. Dibella has herself several eyes on her dress, although she has her own closed. Fact that, as the goddess of beauty, art and sexuality, she wears a full dress, unlike her Cyrodiilan counterpart, not showing any nudity or exaggerated appealing features in order to wear several sets of eyes and looking herself like a moth is really intriguing. Yet, it highlights the importance of the vision element. She almost looks herself like a priestess or mystic of some sort. The only moth species which meanings emphasize so much on vision is the ancestor moth. After all, ancestor moth monks are being progressively blinded through the reading of the scrolls, and the moths themselves allows people who couldn't normally read it to read. Ancestor moths are trading in a way the organic and material vision to obtain a metaphysical and mystical one. It is so true that the more a person is blinded, the more he has a clear understanding or an amount of information coming from the scroll, as the book Effects of the Elder Scrolls mentioned. If you are a naive mind that can't comprehend a thing about the scrolls, your vision will not be altered at all. Unguarded intellect goes completely blind at the first reading but obtain a real piece of hidden knowledge. Knowledge that comes in a much more enigmatic way for those who only gradually become blind, as they have to meditate longer to understand what they just read. It will be much easier to link Dibella to the physical and material vision, as she is not supposed to refer to any immaterial beauty and love. That is rather more fitting for Mara. Remember, Dibella's cult and temples are full of performers, colorful paintings and ornaments, sexual and attractive statues or clothes. However, this is not entirely true. Dibella is not sanguine. Her cult is not about debauchery and mere sensorial pleasure. She doesn't teach the sake of physical beauty, colors and art in a self-centered way, but nuances it with more metaphysical or psychological traits. She indeed teaches friendship, to respect one another in the grace added in each other's life. She inspires artists to produce such wonderful works that everyone seeing it finds his life embellished. She teaches a meaningful and beautiful relationship to the world, other, and oneself. What is the link with vision or all the eyes representation, you may ask? Well, when you think about artists or even sexuality, one phenomenon can transpire: inspiration. Beauty can hugely inspire people to support themselves, to create and procreate, to share. Artists pray to Dibella to receive inspiration, but it can also be seen as intuition. They beg to have an almost natural insight to see what is behind the common, to have a grasp of what is hidden, exceptional and graceful. And intuition is commonly represented as an eye, especially the third one. Inspiration and intuition are, in fact, not really under Yunyol's nor Herman Mora's influence. For logic, mathematics, reading actual books, and searching theories are a conscious and long-term effort. Intuition that strikes you like lightning, both to create the new greatest piece of art or to hear your heart racing for no reason when you're looking at someone, is right in Dibella's sphere. Dibella doesn't teach to work hard to gain access to hidden knowledge, but rather to have sudden revelations, immediate comprehension, and bursts of insights, which is how the ancestor's moth helped monks to read another scroll. Don't forget that it is through singing, weaving silk in intricate patterns, gathering fragrant bark with an ornate golden blade in some of the most magnificent glades you will ever find in Tamriel that monks can read and comprehend the scrolls. The importance of singing to read an Elder Scroll is not to be ignored. Again, an ancestral Morph monk doesn't search for theories, doesn't experiment and study physical nor magical laws to obtain something from the scroll or from the Morph. He rather wants to have a clear, immediate understanding of what he has in front of him. Preparedness is important to prevent the damage that this comprehension causes, but not to allow the comprehension itself. Reading a scroll is hugely intuitive, full of melody, strange colors and glowing patterns, light and insight. Even unprepared intellects, as the name suggests, can understand an Elder Scroll at the price of their vision, but they have a clear understanding of what they just read, unlike reading an academic book. If you are not prepared, doesn't have the knowledge, you will not comprehend a damn thing. Weaving the silk, singing to moths, and hearing them humming back seems really Dibella-like to me. In fact, I almost see the ancient moth as muses or diamonds. You can't really hear what they say, but the melody helps you understand things you wouldn't be able to, leading you with utmost intuition. Muses were Minos divinities in ancient Greek and Roman pantheon, believed to give inspirational thoughts and gifts to humans, making them proficient in literature, arts, and science. At the gift shows, they mostly act without calculated effort made by the receivers. Artists pray to muses to receive sudden dreams and thoughts that will inspire them. Diamonds, in the other end, were lesser spirits believed to link the gods and humans, each human having a diamond associated at his birth. These diamonds gifted their humans with luck, thoughts and dreams. Some ancient philosophers, such as Plato, attributed some of their theories and reflections to their diamond. This messenger function is also present in the game. The ancestors' moths are indeed believed to carry the furion of the ancestor with them, which is sung in their silk and humings. The furion means the will for peace of the ancestor. The ancestor moths are material beings that allow dead ancestors to speak with alive people to help them, which means that they are literal ancestors' messengers. In addition, the etymology of the word muse can be from the Greek word musai, which means to have in mind or put in mind, like to remember or recall something. It's also interesting to see that the ancestor moth monks are often considered as gifted with prescience since their birth, as not everyone can become a monk of this cult. If it was under the influence of Yunyol, I don't understand why birth gifts would be such an important thing, as he teaches the expertise that someone can reach thanks to studying. Such divination gift is also well known in Dibella's cult, as it is leaded by a woman with a Sibyl title, as she is able to directly communicate with the goddess. The word Sibyl is again from ancient Greece. A Sibyl is a woman gifted with divination abilities, so that she can see the future and tell prophecies. However, this gift was believed to come from a divine inspiration, which often resulted in riddles and singings. For me, there is little doubt that both the delicate features, the prophetic abilities through singings and silk weaving, and the link with intuition and inspiration rather than studying are the main reasons as why Dibella was associated with the moth in ancient Nordic belief system. Much more than moths being the animal of Yunyol or Hermamora. Well, my little skivers, I hope you enjoyed this video as much as I enjoyed making it. Don't hesitate to share your own thoughts about it and to bring up your own theories on this topic. I wish you a great day and see you in the next video.